feel like I'm on CNN here. My name's Mark. I'm an alcoholic and a cocaine addict. And power of God showed up in my life the morning of October 19th of 1982. And that power has remained with me from that moment, which is why I'm able to sit before you clean and sober. Many times in that journey, I have not felt the presence or been asleep to that which is always present. Power, God. I always find it humorous now when someone says to me they want to get closer to God. We're like fish swimming in the water, and God's the water, and you want to get closer. It is impossible. Wake up to what is already there, what is within you. And I will talk about that. My home group is the Carry This Message group in Austin, Texas. When I got sober, CA wasn't around, so my influences were very heavily in the rooms of AA. And over the years, I've spent some time in CA, and as a matter of fact, I sponsored a gentleman, Mike D., who just moved to Austin. Mike's got 21, 22 years, and he just started a group on Sundays, which I'm starting to go to regularly. They're very mired in the solution, which is really what I'm all about. I always like to share with people, before I do anything, where I am currently. Your body cannot live off the food you ate 2 weeks ago. And if you're sitting here trying to live off an old experience, you're headed for trouble. I stay current with every aspect of my life. On a daily basis, Monday through Friday, I get up at 4:30. I spend an hour in prayer and meditation. That is not to impress anybody. That is to stay in fit spiritual condition, to operate and live and move and have my being in a world that scares me to this day, that I am ill-equipped to deal with. And I'm glad I know that. I have a meditation practice since 1991. I will talk about that. I really had to ask my Creator to guide me. I do weekends on the 10th and 11th step, an entire weekend. So I'm supposed to share with you in 1 hour. See, I'm incapable of that. I was asked, are you nervous? The answer is no. You do the work 1 through 9 and work with 10 and 11, you become a hollow bone. Right in the middle of the fear inventory is a sentence never talked about. I will let God demonstrate through me what God can do. You do this and stay in fit spiritual condition, and that's exactly how your life will get lived. God will demonstrate through you what God can do. I have no capacity to not snort cocaine for 27 years. That is impossible, let alone to have any degree of sanity. I don't have any experience with that. So, every year, I resubmit to the first 9 steps, and I'll talk about why I do that. A sidebar. I want to devote this talk to one of my teachers. His name is Paul Martin. Paul Martin passed away last week. Paul Martin was 62 years sober. He was 87 years old. Amazing man. He was in my lineage. I learned a lot from him. Many of my influences have left their bodies. As a matter of fact, there's only one left in the lineage line. But his name is Gary B. Gary lives in Indianapolis, Indiana. Don Fritz, who carried the message to me initially, and in hindsight, my capacity to see it, hear it, was somewhat limited. He's passed and gone. My good pal Joe Hawk has passed and gone. another man that had a huge influence on me, called him Big Frank, lived in Denver. Now those men did for me. The only thing I can do for you is share with you a course of action I have taken to have an experience. And that is what they did with me. I cannot impart knowledge to you. I can't impart any of that. I can share with you my experience with instructions out of the book and the course of action I took and the subsequent experience that I have had, am having, and then I'm left with words to try and describe that to you. I only do this kind of things 6 times a year. Several years ago, I took 3 years off and did no speaking. As far as I can tell, silence is the language of God. And it's where I like to spend my time. However, I feel if I can 6 times a year come to a place like this, and if I get one person who said, my God, the program is so much more than I ever thought, and I will do this, and they have an experience, it was worth the trip. So that's why I still do this, to share with you. Because if it happened for me, it can happen for any of you. As far as I can tell, the Creator has no grandchildren. We all get to have a direct experience. How much of it do you want? Go to the ocean for the thimble, you get a thimble full of water. It's not God's fault you want a thimble. If you're a hog for cocaine, you better be a hog for God. It doesn't work any other way. Work with some of these guys and they'll go on 5, 6, 7 day runs and mortgage the house and every relationship for cocaine, and then you talk to them about the distance of 10 to 11. They look at you like that's a bit much. Then they want to blame God because they don't get the results, correct? Spiritual law, learn it early, learn it fast, learn it quick. God will never do for you what you're supposed to do for yourself. I had to set the alarm this morning and get up and get my feet on the floor, as Big Frank used to say. Get your feet on the floor, boy. Start that day. Start with the daily disciplines. Upon awakening, do the prayers. Do the meditation. Be quick to see where religious people are right. 10 to 11 is all the juicy, the meat, man. It's what this program's about. 1 through 9 is a launching pad. Without solid work in 4 through 9, 10 to 11 are theoretical concepts which you cannot experience and transmit and take into your life. Because 10 and 11 is new language. It is not language designed to speak to your mind. To know God, you must be out of your mind. The theme is the fourth dimension. The speaker behind me is going to talk about that. Common sense told me one dimension I experience myself is physically. I experience myself emotionally. That's another dimension. I experience myself mentally. As my pal Mike says, the little minions. Your eyes popped open this morning, little minions started talking to you. We got to get coffee, got to get this, got to get this. You know, I'm supposed to got to do prayer and meditation. They just go, go, go. Got to be at work on Monday. I first started meditating, it felt violent to me. I had no idea I had so many voices. Good God, no wonder we shoot ourselves in the head instead of the foot. It's to stop the voices. See? The thunder of meditation is what I called it. Amazing stuff. So I want to read something which I think says a lot, because if you're going to talk about 10 and 11, you've got to talk about the God issue. This is one of many books that have allowed me to awaken. It's called 365 Tao Daily Meditations. This is called the donkey. It says, dismount your donkey at the summit. Some places in this world are very hard to climb, and people will use animals. Each person can only ride one, and each animal might have a different name. The riders go up the trail in different orders, and they will discuss their varying opinions about their experiences. They even may have conflicting opinions. One traveler may think the trip thrilling, another may find it terrifying, and a third may find it boring. At the summit, all the travelers stand in the same place. Each of them has the same chance to view the same vistas. The donkeys are put to rest and graze. They are not needed anymore. We all travel the path to God. The donkeys are the various doctrines each of us embraces. And we have different donkeys within our fellowship. We have the big book thumper donkeys. We have the back to basic donkeys. We have a lot of different donkeys. Think about that as I read this. The donkeys are the various doctrines each of us embraces. What does it matter what doctrine we embrace as long as it takes us to the summit? My challenge to you is if the donkey you're on is not getting you to the summit, get a new one. Your donkey might be a Zen donkey. Mine might be a Tao donkey. They're Christian, Islamic, Jewish, and even agnostic donkeys. All lead to the same place. Why poke fun at others over the name of their donkey? Aren't you riding one yourself? We need to put aside both the donkeys and our interim experiences once we arrive at the summit. Whether we climb in suffering or joy is immaterial, we are there. All religions have different names for the ways of getting to the holy summit. Once we reach the summit, we no longer need names and we can experience all things directly. 10 and 11 are about the view from the summit. Once a year, I resubmit to the first 9 steps. Why do I do that? It is because I cannot defeat my ego. Don't care how long you're clean and sober, your ego will take the very best of you out of here with its plan, its design. You cannot defeat it. My teachers taught me that, and my experience taught me that. What starts to happen to me is my meditation starts to become flat. And the voices get louder. And you all begin to annoy me more. And I start to become the AACA policeman. A lot of different things begin to show up in my life, and I realize what has happened. It's called reconstruction of the ego, in which I had a valid spiritual experience. And as it said, right before I do the third step, with God's help, I can be entirely rid of self. And I have been able to experience being rid of self for a long period of time. The subsequent peace on an internal and external basis that comes with that. I can work with the isness of life, death, sadness, joy, everything. I love it all. It's all meaty. It's juicy. Then I start to get afraid more. So I see what I'm up against. I'm rubbing up against myself, and I cannot defeat that. I cannot pray that away. I cannot think that away. I cannot talk that away. So I resubmit to the process. I start with 4 basic questions. I had 3 men who came to me and said, will you be willing to go through and show us how you rework the first 9 steps in a 30-day time window? I said, sure, since I'm getting ready to do that. So we took 4 questions and we sat with these questions for a week and we wrote out answers to them. And some of you may be wondering, why isn't he talking about 10 and 11? You'll soon see why. First question is, do I want to live? See, for me, to do cocaine is to die. I know how to stay fit spiritual today. Do I want to live? Do I want to continue to live? Because what I choose to do on a daily basis now is simply that. It is a choice. I am awake today. Do I want to continue to live? And the actions in the core that I take on a daily basis will confirm that. So that was my first question. Because for a guy like me to do cocaine is to die, and I do not mean physical death. When I drink vodka or I snort cocaine, I die the death of everything of any value in my life. I die the death of relationships and friendships and jobs and the ability to drive and money and everything. I destroy everyone in my life who cares about me. So that's what I mean about, do I want to live? So I sit with that. Here's what else I ask myself. Second question. Do my actions on a daily basis show that I want to live? Am I merged in the program, all three parts, recovery, unity, and service? Am I doing my daily disciplines? Or am I just coming to meetings, bullshitting you, telling you what I used to do? Or am I doing that? If you had a video camera on me for a week, would they demonstrate that I'm doing the things necessary to stay in fit spiritual condition? Third question, do I want what you have and I'm willing to go to any lengths to get it? Important question once you're sober for a while. I am no longer naive. I've done a lot of work with the steps. I am free of this idea that I'm going to rework the steps and the outcome is going to look nice. I have reworked the steps and I have lost jobs and relationships, endured hardship, etc. I know that I'm dealing with real power. I know that I'm dealing with the power of God in my life. And I don't know what that looks like. And when I was sitting back in April, my life's pretty damn good today. I don't know if I want this apple cart upset again. Not quite sure. Got to sit with that question. Because you are dealing with real power. CA, the big book, this is not a program of self-help in which you get and keep yourself clean and sober. This is a program in which you're designed to get in touch with a power greater than yourself, which is closer than breathing, which will guide and direct you the rest of your life. It is about real power that you take into every area of your life and all your relationships and into work and your capacity to love and be of service. To be a friend, to be a mother, to be a father. That's what this program's about. It's not do drugs. Bullshit. Shit, if that's all this room gave me, you'd have someone else up here. I was a hog out there. I gotta be a hog in here. See, I can't go one way or the other with it, right? So do I want what they have? Am I willing to go to any lengths again? Fourth question is, am I willing to resubmit to the process of 1 through 9? Yeah, we sat with that for a week. We met. We spent about 4 hours reviewing the first 3 steps. Looking at the craving of the body. Is this me? Does this happen to me? When I snort a line of cocaine, do I lose power, choice, and control over how much? Yes, I see it. The obsession of the mind, to me, one of the most misunderstood parts of the book. That part of me that I will commit the most insane act of my life, stone cold sober. And that is that my mind at certain times will convince me to drink or do drugs and I will act on that on my power. And I see that. That is not a good feeling. At my very best on my power, I will use again. That is my experience. There's nothing good about that feeling once you wake up to that. Too much focus on what happens once it's in my body. Put the focus on when it's not. Put your focus there. Looking at my current unmanageability. Current unmanageability, not old stuff. Using page 52 as the criteria. Having trouble in personal relationships. How is it? Look around yourself, people you're closest to. What is it like? Is there tension there? Is it good here? How is it at work? How is it in the fellowship? How is it with your sponsee? How is it with your sponsor? How is it with money? How is it with the IRS, credit cards? How is it with your physical body? Produces what we call tension. Little tension. How is it with fear? How do you do? come to a new group of people, you don't know people. Are you afraid? Or do you have an inner calmness? Can you look people in the eye? You sit with that. We all had our current unmanageability that we were looking at. We all shared that. And what we do is in the second step, we take the current unmanageability into the second step and ask ourselves this question, can God take me past here? Past here. Are there dimensions I know nothing about God can take me into in every area of my life in all four dimensions? Am I willing to go for that? Whoa, second step, yeah. Yeah, there's aspects of God I haven't even begun to touch. Third step, am I convinced my life, drunk or sober, ran on my will, cannot and will not work, and we sit with that. And then the book finally addresses what's really wrong with all of us in this room and what would take any one of us back. I live in the delusion that I will be happy and satisfied if I only manage well. Part of managing well is every detail of my life. Who's in my life? How you act? How I need you to be? How the economy is? What my bank account should look like? Etc., etc., etc. Am I suffering again from that delusion? If my arrangements would only stay put, if only you all would do as I wish, the show would be great. Am I suffering from that again? And that creates more tension, and tension, and tension. And then we said that and made that decision at the bottom of page 62 about that incredible relationship with God. Director, God's going to be my principal. I'm going to be God's agent. God's going to be my father. God's going to be my employer. I love it. I was looking for that my whole life, and I got it. So I make that decision. I say that incredible third-step prayer. No amen behind that prayer. 3 through 7 are a package deal. Now, which I offer myself to God to build with me and do with me as thou wilt. Why? Why would I do that? Because what God has done with me is far better than what I did with me. When I came to you October 19th of 1982... I had brain damage, kidney damage, liver damage, everything I owned fit in a little duffel bag. And I wasn't any family. I snored them all up. I drank them all up. I burned it and churned it. Just like the book says, I'm a tornado. That's what I do on my own. That's why I make that third step decision. There's nothing within me that tells me on my own power I will not go back to that place again. And I don't question why. I just know that is my experience. And I don't want to go back to that place again. Hell, death doesn't scare people in this room. Look at the shit we've done. You know what terrifies us is life. Life. See? Then we wrote inventory, resentment inventory. 4-column. Very thorough 3rd column. Don't just use the words, affected self-esteem, pride, etc. I write out a lot about the 3rd column. 3rd column, you better see where you're playing God. 3rd column is not about low self-esteem. It's about a little bit too much high self-esteem. It's about judgment. Everything you write in the 2nd column, you're writing it in the 2nd column out of your judgment in the 3rd, because in the 3rd you are God. Quick example. Employee. Guy known for a while. Reports, direct report to me. 2nd column. Acts like a child. Sulks when given direction. Needs to grow some balls and grow up. I love writing the 2nd column. Boy, I don't pull any punches and I don't pretend I'm nice because I ain't. And you got that going on. Get rid of that one. This is not a group of nice people. When you're right, how is it with inventory? No. Self-esteem. Oh, I know what else was in the 2nd column. If he'd be doing 10 to 11, he wouldn't be acting like a child. Third column, self-esteem. I'm a step worker. I'm in fit spiritual condition. I'm a man with balls. I'm a man of integrity. My self-esteem stuff. Pride. No one should see that I've hired someone who acts like a child. You're still trapped in that delusion of getting who you are from outside yourself. Than how others think you give some value to. This program hopefully will do for you what it did for me. My entire sense of self is derived from the inside out. What does that mean? It means you can add to my life, but you can't take nothing from me. Ever. Including your absence. You can only add to me. Ambition. Ambition is where? What do I want? I want him to be a grateful, dutiful, respectful employee. Follow my direction at all times. Act like a warrior. Surrounded by Indians, shooting him with arrows, and he's taking it like John Wayne. I want no trouble. I want him to learn everything it took me 18 years to learn in 1 month. So that I don't have to spend my time training him. See, I ain't a nice guy either, am I? See, I didn't see any of this till I started writing inventory. Like, security, what do I need to be okay? I need him to act this way because I've sponsored him. And I won't look good. See? Ooh. Need him to be successful so my business is successful. Because if my business isn't successful, I don't exist and I'm fighting for my life. One little piece of inventory and I'm fighting for my life and I see it. Personal relations, belief systems about men. Men act like men, not children. Men are respectful of their elders. Sex relations, belief systems about women. Women don't like men, don't have balls. Who are weenies. Women like real men. John Wayne's. Carry the load. Suck it up. You know? Money. I am my money. See? That's my third column. This is a guy I've known for 11 years. We rode many trails together. I go in the foxhole with him. This is the shit I'm up against. Almost 27 years sober. See? And that was one of 7, 8, 9, 10 pieces of inventory I write. You see my fourth column coming off that kind of writing? The third? My stuff's all over the page, isn't it? One of the most powerful lines that today that I work with in the 10th and 11th comes to me from all of Mark's troubles or Mark's own making. And I take that into 10 and 11. They're a framework for 10 and 11 because that's where all my power comes from. If there were any troubles in my life that were not of my own making, then something outside of me has to change in order for me to get better. And there's no power in that. No power whatsoever. So we finished those inventories, the fear inventory we just wrote on our basic fears, the ones we were dealing with now. The fears I'm dealing with now are not the fears I dealt with a year ago or 2 years ago or 3 years ago. I'm only interested in my current experience and my current reality. I had four fears. Sex inventory. We met, gave ourselves 1 week to write inventory. Now one of these guys is 21 years sober, one's 6 years sober, one's three. I've worked with all of them. I've sponsored all of them. They stay very current. These are not long inventories. We met. We all read inventory to each other and did our fifth step. We did six and seven. The tool I use for that is the sacraments of penance. If you read the big book, it talks about when you're reading your inventory, you're looking for the exact nature of your defects. That's the best tool I've ever seen to help me give a name to my defects. My first profound experience with the sixth and seventh step came through the use of that tool. Be happy to give anyone my cards and send it to you. That's all I look for is tools to take within the framework of the instructions I was given in the sixth step, which is marked, find your defects. Boy, that does it. And the profound effect I had behind that is at the time, the first time I used that, I'd use various tools. I'd just work with the seven deadly sins, etc. But I didn't have any real inner connection or experience with my defects. And through the use of that tool, I saw how I fell short and I fall short every time. And if that is true of me, I love God first and foremost. And if that is true of me, that is true of all of us. Then who am I to sit in judgment? You and I are equals in every sense of the word. And I felt it and I saw it, and to this day that has had an impact on me. Then we made our list of amends, and I went out and made the amends. Sat down and I cleaned it up. Now my pals, we don't go around eggshells around each other. You know, so but I sat down and I cleared all that up. Now what happened? Now I come up to the 10th step. I told you I was going to talk about 10 and 11. See, I did a 12-minute meditation before I came here. I don't know what you need. You needed what has been shared up to this point, though. I can tell you that. Why do I know that? Because that is what has happened here. Now I come up to the 10th step, and now the 10th step is 10th step for me is about line of the will. Now I come to the 10th and 11th step again, but now I'm on new footing. Because of the body of work I just did. Because of the experiences that I've had. What showed up for me? Thomas Merton. Book of Daily Meditations. He wrote not too long before he died, when he's living in a hermitage by himself on the monastery. And I know why that came into my life. Here's a man living in a hermitage, one of the most prolific writers of all times, and he and I are having the same daily discussions with the minions. He uses different words, but we're up against the same stuff. Emmett Fox got thrust back into his book, Find and Use Your Inner Resource. Found out where a lot of verbiage out of our big book came from, by the way. Things like way of life, thought life. Started to get meaty and juicy for me again. 365 Tao started to get meaty and juicy for me again. And then I turned to this. I distinguish between the 10th and 11th step in this fashion. And I'll talk about the 10th step first. The 11th step is what I do at home in the morning. My cat hobo. Pointing my attention while I'm doing this spiritual work. That's the 11th step. And then the 11th step is also where I sit down with my book and I answer those questions and do my evening review and do prayer and do meditation. Sometimes. The meditation. 10th step is what I use when I walk out my door and I get in my car and I got to interact with you all day long. This is why I'm going to talk about the 10th step. The 10th step is like an abyss to me. The 10th and 11th step are about a daily set of practices we get to do until we die. Get rid of this idea there is some arrival place. There is not. You have opened the door or been launched into the spiritual dimension. And for the rest of my life, I now get to practice the use of my awakened spirit in this material world. And you're going to see words that we're going to talk about like watch, ask, cease, turn, ask. Cease fighting, line of the will, sixth sense, pause. It's like working out. You take a word and you go 6 months. You could take the word ask and work with it as a spiritual practice. The word turn, the word cease fighting. Anything or anybody. These are practices that we get to work with to go through the day in a world that we're ill-equipped to operate in. talks about this thought, the thought of finishing your amends. On that note, your capacity to practice, experience, live 10 and 11 is greatly enhanced as you move through the amends. My experience with that is, here is why. There is the idea that there is nothing but oneness and only the illusion of separation. The experiences I have confirmed that is probably true. If I have unfinished amends or I have resentments and God is in you, then I am blocked, aren't I? And that is why move through amends. Do not fall prey to a standard party line of finish 25% of your amends. Always remember, I always tell people all the time, I don't care what your sponsor says. What does the book say? What does the book say? What does the book say? Don't ever let anyone read your big book for you. Book said in the eighth step, I made a list of all persons. Do you think that means all? Probably. It's back to the thimble. You want a thimble or do you want more? I work with all. Takes a long time. That's okay. Your capacity to practice 10 and 11 is greatly enhanced as you move through the process of amends. As you pay the money back, as you clean it up with family, past employers, male friends, female friends, going back as far as you can remember. High school, 7th grade. I went back to 7th grade teacher. Made amends for being such a pain in her ass. In 7th grade. Why would I do that? Because it was blocking me. Because what I did wasn't right. She was trying to help me. And of course, it's, when you go to make that kind of amend, it never is what you think it is. So remember that. This thought then of going through the amends brings me to step 10. It suggests I continue to take personal inventory and continue to set right any new mistakes as I go along. This is about being awake during your day. This is about going maybe in to get a cup of coffee. Maybe you're real short because they're real busy and they're not getting to you fast enough because we all deserve our own lane. And you're awake enough to realize that and you turn and you say, you know, I apologize. It says, we vigorously commence this way of living. There's those three words. You could spend a month taking into meditation. What does that mean? A way of living. As I cleaned up my past, so I begin to work with these disciplines as soon as I begin to make amends. That's the instruction in the book. As I cleaned up my past, I've entered the world of the spirit. A door opened. Fourth dimension. I have an awakened spirit. 4 through 9 cleared out what had me blocked from an awakened spirit. My first profound experience with this was at my father's funeral. Sobered up in 82. Died of alcoholism in 86. I went to his funeral, open casket. I'm looking at my father's body and this thought went through my mind. Your father is not there. And I got it. What I thought was my father was that body. What was my father was not there, but I knew it still lived. And I said, my God, that is what the big book means. The world of the spirit. It was visual proof of this line. Goosebumps. It still puts goosebumps. I got it. My God, all my life I thought that was my father. No. He had an animated spirit. That was gone. I don't know what that is. Eat it for lettuce in a year, you know. But see, I'm the kind in this spiritual stuff, I got broad shoulders and a big ass, and I got to see it like that. I gotta see it. I gotta have the same experience with this stuff that I did with cocaine. It's gotta be real and live, and I gotta see it, feel, and that woke me up. My God, I have that is me. That is my essence. This body is not who I am. This whole thing then is about working with that. And you got one of those too. Who I think you are is not that body at all. Something much more than that. That's what the world of the spirit is, to wake up to this that I'm talking about. And now my next function in what? With an awakened spirit is to do what? Is to grow an understanding and effectiveness. With what? With my awakened spirit as I go through every minute of my day in my interactions with you at work, at play, and everything. To grow an understanding and effectiveness with an awakened spirit. Not an overnight matter. It should continue for my lifetime. I get to practice. Continue for my lifetime. Now it gives me some practices. Continue to watch. Watch is a 10-step practice that I've worked with. Month after month after month after month. Doing what? With an awakened spirit, you literally watch yourself. It's no different than my hand just moved. I watched myself. You can watch yourself think. You can watch yourself talk. You can watch yourself. It's a practice. Watch yourself. Watch the impact you have on others. Take one word. Work with it. When I work with this stuff, I take a 3x5 card. I write the word. I put it in my car. I put it in my mirror. I put it at work. Right now on my computer it says, cease fighting anything or anybody. I'm practicing that. That's how I must keep it in my awareness, and I continue to practice. So I continue to watch for what? Selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. See, an awakened spirit does not mean that Mark still doesn't exist. And Mark gets afraid, and Mark gets dishonest, and Mark gets resentful. And I get to watch myself have that experience. When these crop up, I ask God at once to remove them. I discuss them with someone immediately and make amends quickly if I've harmed anyone. Remember, 10th step, tools you work with during the day. If you find yourself in the middle of the road with an 18-wheeler bearing down on you, that is not the time to contemplate how you got there. You better move. That's what the 10th step is. Don't confuse 10 and 11. 10 allows you and I to move through the day. Get into work. Phone starts ringing. Employee calls in sick. Got a problem here. Here. Pause. Turn. Cease. Watch. Ask. How can I best serve thee? Pause. Thy will, not mine, be done. Ask right thought, right action all day long. Staying present to what's coming at you. That's what the 10th step is, all day long. Juicy, meaty shit to work with. Can I pause? Can I stay neutral? Resolutely turn. Turn is a practice. Try it. Look up the word turn. Don't assume you know what these words mean. Look up the word and you practice. So you got to get the force away from you. The force is what? The force is your ego. You feel yourself getting afraid. Turn what? Turn to God thought. God is with me. God helps me. First start working with this. You get in situations like the young lady introduced me. Afraid. Turn. God help me. God guide me. God direct me. Turn. Turn. Line of the will. You get done with the 11th step in the morning, and you're hooked up, baby. Humming inside. Just think of it as a line. You go get in your car, and you come up, and somebody comes up right behind you. Bastard. Line of the will, right? And the light takes a little too long, and the minions are talking. You got to get to work. Got a lot to do. Boom. I started out here. I'm already here. And then I turn, I get to work, and I get a call. The office manager's going to be sick. Boom, now I'm here. I started out here, hooked up, purring. It's all good. Got some residents. They're not doing well. They're not following my recommendations. Boom. Banker calls. Boom. started here. Guess where I'm at? If I got no practices, I got no tools. Where in the hell do you think you're at when you go to an 8 o'clock meeting at night? You're wrapped around yourself. Then imagine a full week of that. But I got tools because the 10 steps line of the will, and I come here, turn back. God is with me. God guides me. Boom. Boom, that will be done. Boom, I'm back. Line of the will. Still purring like a cat, baby. Line of the will. Come back. Come back. Line of the will. Practice. Turn. See? That's what 10-step tools are all about. All of this. All day long. Love and tolerance of others becomes my code. Without doing the work in 4 through 9, you have no capacity to practice this. Why? Because the world's got assholes in it. Love and tolerance is my code. The more asleep people are, the crazier they act. Whether it's in a car or wherever, love and tolerance. You can't practice that with an intact ego. This needs to bring compassion, see? I've ceased fighting anything or anyone, dash, even alcohol, even cocaine. Cease fighting anything or anyone. My God, what an incredible practice that is. How do you translate that? It means let people be who they are, having whatever experience they're supposed to have, and quit concerning yourself so much with what you think you need from them. Cease fighting anything or anyone. Incredible practice. Awesome practice. You just sit with that. See, when you first start practicing, here's the first thing you're going to notice. How you fight everything and everyone. That's the starting place for the practices. I started working with turn. By about 3 in the afternoon, I realized I hadn't turned one time. See, it starts with how much we are asleep. How we fail so bad. It starts there. I still remember pausing, agitated or doubtful. Shit. You know, I was into my amend before a pause even occurred to me. Practice, 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 practice. You know, I don't know what some of you do for a living. Whatever it is, it takes a long time to be good at it. That is true of this too. But again, how much of it do you want? I've ceased fighting anything or anyone. Here's why. Because for this time, sanity will have returned. That is the definition of sanity. Can you work with the isness of life? Doesn't mean you always have to like it. Can I work with it? That's what cease fighting is. Talks about then, I am seldom interested in liquor. If tempted, I recoil from a hot flame, and you'll notice if you've ever recoiled from a hot flame, you give no thought to that. It happens automatically. This new attitude you and I was given to us with no thought or effort on our part, it just comes. That's the miracle of it. I've been placed in a position of neutrality. I am safe and protected. Originally, when I began to work with the position of neutrality, it was around cocaine and vodka. It morphed into far more. I didn't even swear off. The problem's been removed. What problem? The obsession that I had with cocaine, self-will run riot, selfishness. Selfishness is the reason for relapse, the manifestation of selfishness. That's what has been removed as a result of the work in 4 through 9. With an intact ego and selfishness in place, it is impossible to experience the fourth dimension. That is my experience. That's the great question in the 10th step. Is that yours? If it's not, go back. See what you missed. Do you have unfinished amends? Do you have unwritten inventory? Are you doing anything with meditation so you can lose your identification with your mind? I'll talk about meditation from a standpoint of between my 9th and 10th year, I wound up in a nut house, kind word for a psych hospital. A lot of that had to do with my identification with my mind and its incessant chatter and my avoiding the instructions in the book about meditation. So if some of you want to have my experience, you can. However, I wish to share with you there's another way. By the way, One of the reasons I still do things like this is for this reason and this reason alone. I have gone through intense suffering in my sobriety at various times because of what I didn't know and what I wasn't doing. And if I can help any one of you to not do that, I want to do that. Do not wait till you're 10 years in this program to start a daily meditation life. Do it now, so you don't have to go to the nut house when the minions drive you wacko. It's not necessary. If you haven't gone back and revisited 1 through 9 in a long time, please do, because of a phenomenon called reconstruction of the ego. Let my suffering and what I didn't do be enough for you. Don't do your own. That's why I share what I do. You don't have to go through what I went through. God will not interfere with Mark's will. It has been said, one of God's greatest gifts to you and I is free will. If that is true, and I'm pursuing a course of action that has very little to do with spirituality, would God interfere with that? Absolutely not. He would be interfering with the gift that was given, or she, or whatever it is. I get clear on that. Don't do what I did. Start working with this stuff now. Watch it change your life. Watch it revolutionize your life. To allow you to do life with everything life gives you. Which is what? The full spectrum. Fabulous times with people you love and care about, and then their death. Prosperity and not. That's life. These tools allow us to move and function in that with a degree of grace and dignity, in a sense that all is still well, and to be able to help others. It says, this is how I react so long as I keep in fit spiritual condition. How many of you have relapse history? Raise your hands. Relapse is about not being in fit spiritual condition. Steps 1 through 9 put me into the area where I can begin to practice what I need to do to stay in fit spiritual condition. And I believe in 1 through 9, a lot of grace operates. But at some point in time, I don't know how much of that grace stays intact once you know what you're supposed to be doing. There's nothing complex about relapse. The book just said, Mark, if you relapse, it's because you were not in fit spiritual condition and has told me how to get there and how to stay there. Everyone wants to come up with all these profound reasons why they relapsed. This is my experience. And I've worked in the field of substance abuse for 19 years. There's such a thing as reincarnation. I wasn't a good person in the last one because I get chronic relapsers to work with as my punishment. So I hear more bullshit than you can ever imagine. But when I sit down and quiz them, most of them have not done anywhere near enough work with the middle steps. A bunch of them have unfinished amends. Very few ever did shit with 10, 11, and they were too selfish to sponsor. And then they wonder why they're not in fit spiritual condition, why they relapse.
Well, it's a mental condition.
No, it's not really. It's a spiritual condition. If you believe the book. See, here's the other idea you must get rid of. So this says that I stay in this position, neutrality, if I'm in fit spiritual condition. Is God a part of that? Yes. But I was shown a course of action. So that means that my involvement on a daily basis to stay in fit spiritual condition is very much a part of why I'm sitting up here clean and sober. It isn't all just about God. Mark has involvement in this. To do what? To stay in fit spiritual condition. To stay in this position of neutrality. It says it's easy to let up in the spiritual program of action and rest in my laurels. Laurels is what I did yesterday. Don't be living off an old experience. Share from what's current in your life. How many of you got over 5 years? Raise your hands. There's a few of you. Don't ever be afraid to share your shit. You know, you get this time, all of a sudden you're this spiritual guy. I hear some of these guys with a long time, I think to myself, they don't even have to go to the bathroom anymore. They're that involved. They're that evolved. I just shared my inventory with you. That's the best I come up with in 27 years. That interesting piece I just went over, where I wanted him to grow balls. See, I'm aware of that. See, people I'm accountable to, they know my current stuff that I'm up against. I'm headed for trouble if I do, for cocaine is a subtle foe. I'm not cured of alcoholism or cocaine addiction. What I'm given is a daily reprieve, contingent on my maintenance of my spiritual condition, period. Doesn't say a damn thing in there about your relationship with God, does it? Or how many times you prayed today. Or how skilled you are in the art of forgiveness. It says, I have a daily repeat contingent on the maintenance of my spiritual condition. And 10 and 11, tell me how to do that. This is not complex. Keep it simple. 10 and 11 tell you and I how to maintain and grow within this spiritual experience. Now you get more instructions to use in the 10th step. Every day is a day when I must carry the vision of God's will into all my activities. How can I best serve thee? Thy will, not mine, be done. Another practice. The will of God is not complex. It is very simple as far as I can tell. Many spiritual teachings from Native American to Christian to Muslim to Buddhist pretty well, I think, tell us. It's simple stuff. I read one the other day from... It was a thing about tidbits about Texas, and there's this little bar in Texas, and they use Texas words to describe the Ten Commandments. Things like, don't take another fellow's wife. Don't be gossiping about your neighbor. Will of God is not complex stuff here. And it's in my very DNA. I'm no different than every one of you in this room. From the time I get up till the time I go to bed, when I'm not following the will of God, I got a little piece of me that goes, red alert! Not supposed to be doing that! Could be as simple as interrupting you when you're talking. You all got the same thing. Then you want to go, wonder what the will of God is. It's pretty simple stuff. The mystery ties into what we said in the third step. I offer myself to thee to build with me and do with me as thou wilt. I have had some discussions with my Creator. I will have another when I leave this body about going to the nut house between my 9th and 10th year for 40 days. I have said to God, if you want me to relocate sometime, let me know in another way. Of course, then I looked at my experience and there were indicators of what I was supposed to be doing with my life, which I chose to ignore. You say that statement to God in the third step, you better understand your life isn't your own business. And as far as I can tell, you taking it back doesn't change it. So I've had dialogues about that. And I am so free of where I live and what I do and who's in my life and who's not in my life. It is not my business. My business is to do what this book says on a daily basis and to let God demonstrate through me what God can do. And when I do that, what comes to me is beyond my wildest dreams. I described to you how I was in 1982. What has God done with me? When I sobered up, when I got clean and sober, I would have had to be cremated because there were not 6 people who could have carried my casket. Today, and when I leave this body, there will be a few more people than that show up for my service. I have many people who love me and care about me. And who I love and care about. I've got a chance to travel all over the world and talk about these steps in God. I've got a chance to be used to help many people over the years, to write a book, to travel, to share great joy and great sadness with lots of different people. And if God will do that for me, God will do that for any of you. Lived a life beyond anything I could have ever imagined. Living a life beyond anything I ever could have imagined. Walk into my closet. I get anxiety deciding what pair of shoes to wear. I got clean and sober, I had two pairs. I love being sober. Too many jackets, which one to wear? God, I got problems today. Which bank account do I withdraw money from? Jeez. Just, I love being sober. Just, you know, electrical company floats me electricity for 30 days and trust that I'm going to pay it. Driver's license, got my picture on it. Man, insurance, I mean, exciting stuff. I love being sober, see? My word is my bond. What incredible stuff. Don't miss this stuff. How can I best serve thee? Thy will, not mine, be done. These thoughts must go with me constantly. It's a practice. I can exercise my willpower along this line all I wish. It is the proper use of the will. I said to you that the 10th step is about the line of the will. These two sentences, pay attention. I can exercise my willpower along this line. There has been a line that has been discussed, hasn't it? A line of neutrality. A line of cease fighting. A line of watch, ask, turn. A line of fit spiritual condition. A line of how can I best serve thee? It is the proper use of the will. Isn't that funny? In the third step, I turn my will over to God. Why? Because I cannot trust it. And in the 10th step, I'm given back and I'm shown there's a line of the will. Talks about I've been receiving strength, inspiration, and direction from Him who has all knowledge and all power. Is that your experience? Strength, inspiration, and direction. If I've done what? The work in 1 through 9, move through the amends, the disciplines of 10 and 11. God is a God of power. Bring a God of power into the rooms. Not this whiny bullshit stuff.
Well, I want to talk about my fears today.
It's just horse shit. Hell, if you're a new person, what would attract you? Power. Good smell and cologne. Dressed appropriately. Power, though. See? Start bringing a God of power into the rooms, into your sponsorship, into the book, into your life. See? Amazing stuff you get to wake up to. You take it into work and into your families and into your relationships. You get to take that kind of a thing into all of this. If I've carefully followed the directions, I begin to sense the flow of God's Spirit into me, and I could add to that and out of me. To some extent, I become God conscious. I begin to develop this vital sixth sense. Sixth sense. What does that mean? Be going along, sixth sense says call. I call. There's a reason. I don't question. I do. I do the same thing with speaking. I don't know why I accepted an invitation to come up here a year ago. People think I'm involved in the choice of that. I still think that's kind of funny because I get requests, and I learned this in one of my Native American teachers. I sit for 3 days. It's called the three-day rule. Go to a medicine man, at least the ones I've had experience with. You won't get much response for about 3 days. Why? Because they want to turn to the Creator. Are they supposed to do anything with you? So I sit, and I'm always shown, yes, go to Toronto. Yeah, but it's November and cold. See, I have these dialogues. Now go to Toronto. Yeah, but it... Go. Okay, fine. Write back and say, yes, I will come. I will be there. Not having a clue why, see? Sixth sense. You wake up to it. Sixth sense. Go here. Do this. Call this. Boom, boom. Look over here. Incredible stuff. It says, but I must go further, and that's going to mean more action. Now, there's a line in here. It says, to some extent, I become God conscious. And then for me, that sentence takes me into what the 11th step is all about, being able to expand beyond to some extent. I will make this statement to you. There is never a time that I'm not aware that I am immersed in God. I stay immersed in God all of the time. And if that can happen for me, it can happen for you. There isn't nothing special going on up here, ladies and gentlemen. I just didn't want to take a thimble to the ocean. I wanted the biggest container I could get. Because life left me empty, loaded or sober. And I saw that. There was either going to be a lot of God consciousness in me or a lot of whiskey and cokey. Period. And I saw that and I got that. I saw I was ill-equipped to operate in this world. Regardless of how successful I had been at times, I am ill-equipped. I don't know why. I don't care. Alcohol and cocaine allowed me to be equipped. And then it didn't. So I'm left with God consciousness. And the work in 4 through 9 take me to the place where I can start to wake up to it and grow within it and have it grow within me and be able to transmit to you. You will transmit what you have. You cannot transmit what you don't have. Step 11 suggests prayer and meditation, two very separate things. By the way, my experience in the rooms around meditation, kindergarten. Want to learn about meditation? Go talk to a Buddhist monk who's been meditating 30 years. Pick up these incredible books that are out there about all these practices. We're kind of like sandlot in terms of learning about this stuff. On that note, I have followed the instructions of the 11th step of being quick to see where religious people are right. Make use of what they offer. I have done that along with and never instead of. I've watched people pray themselves right back to dope. Walked out of the rooms and into religion. Do it along with and not instead of. I've had many influences, many teachers, along with, not instead of, Native American, Buddhism, Order of Saint Benedict, Self-Realization Fellowship, taught me about meditation. Native American connected me with Mother Earth again. Order of Saint Benedict connected me with you. With God at a profound level. All these incredible disciplines. Do it along with and never instead of. I was awakened and brought into the rooms and given this. This. I don't need to improve upon it. My teachers, Paul, who just died, Don Pritz, Big Frank, this is how simple it is. When they died with all that sobriety, I noticed they still had a home group and a sponsor. And they liked to rework 1 through 9. And they had a whole bunch of whiny, snivelly sponsees. And they worked with meditation. And their libraries were full of juicy stuff from Emmett Fox to Paramahansa Yogananda to Wallace Black Elk to... And they're always looking for two-headed giraffes, you know. Just why? Because the world of spirit is so broad. This is not complex. They did a lot of stuff, but they all did it along with and never instead of. Watch, two guys got so immersed in meditation, one day their head said that the meditation had cured them of the phenomenon called craving. And they thought they would try that. And one of them burned his house down after about 3 months. Don't have a clue what's going on with the other one. Talks about better men than us are using it constantly. By the way, whenever the word Big Book uses the word it, see if you're awake to what it means. It says it works if I have the proper attitude and work at it. And the proper attitude is discussed on page 55, and it has three components. I lay aside my prejudice. The word prejudice means your preconceived belief or opinion. About what? Everything. When I woke up this morning here, everything that happens from the first breath to the last, I have never been in or experienced before. Some of you who I've met before, I don't know you now. It is so new, so fresh, so meaty, so juicy, it renders me speechless most of the time. But you got to be awake to understand what I just said. God, you don't get no better. Never been in this now before. Oh, and bored. No, you're asleep. Dreaming you're awake. You think because your eyes are open, you are awake, you are wrong. One of my favorite phrases I went through most of my life, asleep, dreaming I'm awake. Thinking I'm making choices. I didn't have a single say in any of my programming from birth to about age 10, and that fuels most of my choices, but I want to sit and look at you and telling you I'm making choices. Sound asleep, dreaming I'm awake. This process woke me up. Then they give the instructions for evening review. Why evening review? To see if you use the 10th step during the day and are you awake to yourself and to your life. That's why you do the evening review. Constructively reviewing your day. When I review my day, I do it from the last thing I did back to the morning. Close my eyes, sit, was I resentful? Boom, boom. Selfish, dishonest, or afraid? Close my eyes, go back. Here, here, here. Do I owe an apology? Have I kept something to myself which should be discussed with another person? Kind and loving toward all, go back through the day. Kind and loving toward all. What could I have done better? Back to kind and loving toward all, the maid. Walk out of my room, go up and do eye contact with her. Give her $5. Thank you for cleaning my room. I appreciate you. Boom. Practice. I couldn't do that when I was brought to this. The minions, we were talking. I didn't even notice the maid. Minions, they had shit to say. We had places to go. We were concerned about ourselves. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Some of you have been here with me and you've heard three sentences because of the minions. Jesus. Is this guy ever going to quit talking about this shit so I can go eat? Nice for him. God damn it, it'll never work for you. Get through all this horse shit, we'll get to the Jeopardy game. You know, whatever. That's how it rolls. See, and you start to have fun with yourself and laugh at yourself. Couple of things, and we're gonna close. I will get a daily meditation line. For God's sakes, get one. I still laugh. I was asked to do going to monasteries, by the way. If you haven't had that experience, go do that. But I was asked to do a weekend on the 10th and 11th and 12th step at a monastery in California. And this is how asleep we are. This is a group of about 30 people. They're asking me to do a... Now, they've been doing retreats at this monastery for 12 years. If you ever want to know why we do the disciplines of 10 or 11 to do things at the set time, go to a monastery. And you will observe at a monastery, they do everything at the set time. 365 days a year. They taught me the value of discipline. That's why Monday through Friday, 4:30 a.m., my feet are on the floor. Because in times when the minions don't want to do it, my feet are still on the floor because it's a habit. They taught me to find God in the pots and the pans, in my dull, boring, mundane, repetitive life. Wow. In washing dishes. In making toast. Find God in the pots and pans. They taught me all those things, and so we're in this incredible monastery. They taught me the sacredness of all things, everything. Incredible how it looked. Said to a monk, tell me about that. And he said, what is not of God? So we handle everything as though it is of God. Woke me up to something again. And I said to him, the irony of you asking me here to do a weekend with you on the 10th and 11th step is you've been coming to a monastery for 12 years, which, without a word spoken, should show you the value of the strict spiritual disciplines of the 10th and 11th step. So I said, I'm only going to do 3 45-minute sessions, and I just want you to experience what goes on in this monastery. And you pick set times to do things, and you do them, regardless. I want to close with this. It's called practice. Spiritual success is gained by daily cultivation. If you practice for the day, you have won. If you were lazy for the day, you have lost. Self-cultivation is the heart of spiritual attainment. Gaining insight and ability is not a matter of grand statements, dramatic initiations, or sporadic moments of enlightenment. Those things are only highlights in a life of consistent activity. Whatever system of spirituality you practice, do it every day. If it's prayer, then pray every day. If it's meditation, then meditate every day. If it is exercise, then exercise every day. Only then will you be able to say you're truly practicing spirituality. This methodical approach is reassuring in several ways. First, it provides you with a process and a means to maintain progress even if that particular day is not inspiring or significant. Just to practice is already good. Second, it will give you a certain faith. If you practice every day, it is inevitable you will gain from it. Third, constant practice gives you a certain satisfaction. How can you say to yourself you have truly entered a spiritual path unless you can look back on years of daily practice and take comfort in the momentum that it has given you? God bless you all. I love you.